Good evening, and thank you for being here. And Singhi is on the program, so we have had four of the five steps. We'll repeat them, and after that we'll play a bit with step number five. Open up. Down. Up. Connect. And split. Peach when. Place and split. Place and split. Out. So we practice peach when left and right on the spot. Of course, normally in Singhi you would walk the step, going forward like that, and from there like that. Now we practice on the spot, and well, that's because of course we have to practice at home. One of the things we can bring into our Singhi practice, actually from Qigong, is if you do not have to think too much about the movement itself, try to feel your abdomen and how it stays in place. So when you move your Singhi, there's the abdomen, of course, that you do not shake it forward and backward while changing sides. It stays on the spot, just rotating around and then a vertical axis. Although Singhi is an explosive style, today we'll practice a bit more gentle. There's a very practical reason for that. It is about 35 degrees Celsius in here, so I won't get fat today. Peach Wen. One of the things we've been talking about by Peach Wen is the vertical circle that the hands make. So up, connecting, continuing and rotating with the hands around a circle, continuously rolling. If you can feel that rotation, if you cannot feel it, let's talk about that first, then it means that you're slightly off. Maybe you're moving a little bit too forward, too much movement in the arm itself. If the arms are connected to the center, and when the center stops rotating, the hands have to be in place. If you abide by that rule, then it should be fine. So there are two types of rotation, this one, and then because you keep the abdomen in on the spot, there's this type of rotation. Try to connect them. So once, when you rotate this, that rotation happens at the same time. There. Focus on that feeling. Notice the position, shoulder, hip, foot, one straight axis. And let's change our view. Moving there. Rotating out. Changing sides. Let's turn again. Move up. Down. Incoming force, an arm. You connect with the inside of your wrist. Don't tap him aside. But use the incoming force to roll and to make your roll. Actually, you connect your rolling action to the incoming line of force. So, not you are making the movement, your opponent is. You are just shaping around it. Now we have to talk about the center. Not as a type of a wheel that rotates, but in the sense of being a center of gravity, a large, heavy ball residing in your abdomen and connecting to the ground through your legs. And of course, the line of force of gravity is straight down. Now, what you want is you want to use the pros and cons of your body. That means that if you stand, let's say, shoulder width with your feet, then your gravity center is, well, in the center. Now, if you slightly move to the side, I am lifting my heel on the other leg so that I do not have to hang in the hip. If I keep my foot flat on the floor and I'd move to the side, now I exaggerate to show, then something like this would have happened. This we want to avoid. The shoulders stay vertically above the hips and you place yourself above one leg. It doesn't matter right or left. What does matter is that when you place your gravity center above that leg, that you do not at the same time rotate. So it actually stays still, apart from the fact that you place it on top of one leg. Now, as you notice, my foot and my upper leg are pointing forward. How does my upper leg point forward? Well, if I look down, I see a direction of my upper leg. And that's the direction you want to have equal to the direction of your foot. Back to the gravity center. You place the gravity center above. And the head, of course, right on top of the gravity center. And now if you release, so you release your contact with the floor with the lighter foot, you release the controlling tension in your hip, then you will rotate all by itself. Not much, but a little bit. Because that's the physical construction of our bone structure. So you place and you let go. This is what is being used in internal styles a lot. So make sure that you know on a physical level how it works. Back to the Pi Chuan. How is this relevant to the Pi Chuan? Of course, you look at the arms. What is he doing with his arms? How does it move? And so on. Actually, it's not that important. This is important. So I'm opening the leg. Don't pay attention to the foot, or less attention to the foot, more attention to the upper leg. It rotates away from my center in the hip joint. Then I place my center without turning or giving way to the front leg. I place it above the front foot. I align myself and I let go, falling downward, not going forward. I am going forward, but I'm not going forward in my mind. In my mind and my awareness, I'm going down. That is a very important thing. Now, it's not only important because that's the way how you get your position on its spot. It's also important because this is how this step generates force. By playing with its your physical control over what happens in that hip joint. So if I just allow things to happen in an even pace, then you get a Pi Chuan like we've been practicing before. Now please pay attention to this front leg and its hip joint. I change my center of gravity from one leg to above the other leg, and then I let go there. And of course, this rotation, that rotation, and so on. But now, let's just pay attention to what happens with the gravity center. Notice the angle of my gravity center. Meaning, let's stand this way, so you can see what I'm doing. So, actually, my abdomen is pointing, let's say, 45 degrees forward. It is in a 45 degree angle. So, now I open up the leg for the step. In the practice and on the spot, I would withdraw it, but then you don't see what I'm doing. So, like in our five steps Tai Chi, you remember your basics. You lift your front foot a little bit, ankle 90 degrees, and then don't move the foot to the side, outward, but rotate in the hip. The abdomen stays still, still pointing into towards that 45 degree angle. Then, like Tai Chi, my center falls above the front leg. I align myself and I allow the center to drop downward, detaching myself, and this will happen all by itself. Well, you can practice it on the spot as well, of course. So you have your position. Now you withdraw your leg. Well, if you withdraw the leg, then the angle of the center will slightly deviate. That's not so relevant. So don't worry about that. As long as this leg and foot from the leg that you've withdrawn is not pointing forward, but outward, from the hip joint down. Open up. Shift your weight to that withdrawn leg and relax the muscles around the hip joint. And you will rotate full through the leg into the foot and into this position. So that is what you're looking. Let's see if you can find it. If you can combine it. Notice how the end of the rotation, because is the end of the rotation actually is the end of its dropping distance through this leg. The end of the rotation also is where the outgoing foot stops and has full contact with the floor, and where the hands stop as well. So a foot, a hand, and here as well, a foot, a hand. Use the dropping sensation of that gravity ball. In the meantime, because otherwise you'll get bored, continuously check the same things like when you're just standing. So soften the back, soften the neck, open the head, sink in the dantian. So chi rises and expands, contracts, rises and expands. Open up, close, and stand. Good, Pi Chuan. The second step was Bong Chuan. Like I explained about the name, it has something explosive. It does not actually mean explosion or something like that, but it is a bang. It's a sound word. So, Bong Chuan. Actually, every Xingyi step starts with Pi Chuan. That's the opening, so to speak. Like in Tai Chi, you have this. Now, in Xingyi, they have a formal opening that we just used. Like there, moving up, Pi Chuan. Well, it is more or less the equivalent of Qi Shi in Yang style Tai Chi. Bong Chuan. Now, like I explained, Bongchuan is, like every single step, of course, a walking step. With this particularity that it always has the same leg up front. So you would go forward like that. Again. So you sink in, as you remember, out. You sink in on the elbow, out, constantly like that. But, same problem as in the previous classes, I have not yet a moving camera following my motion, so we have to practice on the spot, and maybe you do not have that space. That means that, although it's not what Singhi does, we have to change left and right front leg. Again. And there you still have the same leg, of course. But you notice how it's hardly possible to stay on the spot. So we have to move something like this. Now it's cross-like. The same thing like in Pichuan applies. Keep the center in the center. If you want to change sides, here we have not actually changed sides, but I mean sides left arm, right arm in connection with the leg. Now we can rotate. See? Release the back in Singhi. What does that mean? You might recall from the Qigong class when we discussed Qigong number 7, where you go down like that. The Qingling Dianshui, the dragonfly, skims the water, so it does not tap like that. It does not dot the water, but it actually strokes over the water, but very small, like if it's a dot. That's a long story to explain something short, but it's really important because I have explained to you the origin of the word dian, where it is the word from Chinese calligraphy, and in Chinese calligraphy they use brushes, not pencils or pens. With a pencil or a pen, you can make a dot like that. If you do that with a brush, you can do it 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 times, but then the hairs are ruined. So you have to make a stroke. Very short, but a stroke nonetheless. Now, where the generation of power is concerned, with a big word, the unfolding of your physical construction, actually, if I exaggerate, in this step, when everything still is close to the center, watch my back, it is slightly curved. Now I exaggerate. And I feel that curve right here. The comparison is often made to a bow, you know, shooting bow and arrow, where this location is the handle of the bow. Now, if you bend a bow, then imagine how you put one tip against the wall and the other tip on the floor. And it cannot unfold. So if you tap on the handle, it will want to explode like that, thus breaking the wall away. That is a bit the idea of this thingy. But, and now the word dian comes into play. If you think of this location, making a point like with a pen or a pencil, like that, it will be too much of a fold and you will damage your back. And here I talk out of experience. You will damage your back, not immediately, but in the event of several months or maybe a bit longer, eventually you will hurt your back. But if you still consider that location, but not as a folding point, a hinge, but as something that you slightly, you strike over it, very short, like that. And that is how you unfold. Then it will be okay. And the lowest part will be right there. So here is my sacrum, the top of the sacrum, and then over the soft part, and there somewhere, don't be too exact about that, it will disperse. Bong Chuan, formal start. Lean, remember the back, still feeling vertical, but you add the back to your awareness. Stroke over the back, thus folding out. Don't make speed, just let it happen. Speed will come. There you go. The same rule applies as with Pichuan. The rotation, when the drop of your, the fall of your gravity center is finished, that is where your position ends. And where your position ends, the hand stops as well. There you go. And close. Good. Now we've been practicing with one foot, same arm, same leg, same side. But like I started to explain, in Xing-Yi you work a bit like a machine gun. It's a rapid machine gun fire, bam, bam, bam. And it's always the same leg forward, like that. So now we do not have 10 meters to practice, but a few steps should be possible. So if you have friends standing close by, tell them to step aside. You need space, not that much. I'll stay on camera. So formal opening, closure, compression, open up, position, lean, there you go. Now, when I fold, all my weight reverts to the rear leg, making it possible for the front leg not to step out. There are no movements in the limbs themselves in internal practice. What happens is that, and again I'll exaggerate, because I fold, my gravity center lowers. I do not want to fold in the hip joint, but as we just practiced, in the back. The hip joint stays open, erect, like there's a vertical pin being put through it. But if I fold the back, I can go slightly lower through the leg, not the hip joint, but the leg, and this leg is being squeezed out a little bit. Now when I unfold, that is what happens with, I'm not stepping with the leg. I'm not making a stomp like that. It's just, I stroke over my back, and thus this leg is being pulled forward, and of course I make my punch that way. So starting here, this is where I fold. Now I have a relatively long step, so I just give it some freedom, but it's not actually going forward. Then I release the back there. And you notice that now the step is way shorter. Meaning that again, when I lean on my elbow, thus skimming over the lower back, the leg can go out there. And there again. This is very exaggerated, but we rotate. There. Usually the foot would end up there, but now we put it on the spot, rotating on the spot. Lean. One. Two. Three. Out. One. Two. Three. Rotate. And out. Why is it always the same side? Because we are using an uneven number. If you want to change sides, one, two, three, four, then use even step. And now we've changed sides. Sorry, my mistake. We'll stay on the same side. Three steps. Don't think about punching, think about releasing the back. One more. change. Silence. One more. Now, if you might wonder what I'm doing with my feet, I don't know about your legs, but I have my left arm forward, right leg at the rear, open up, and I follow the rotation of my arm with my center like that, and then the leg will automatically rotate. There, completing the rotation, like that. So, again, now we are already playing with the step. Rotate up, like that. Rotate the center. The leg will follow. Change your weight to rotate out. One more, up, Bong Chuan, there, One more, up, the center follows the rotation of the upper arm, the leg follows the rotation of the center, and complete the rotation with Peach Man. Open up and close. Well, we have already arrived at step number three. Step number three was Zhuan Quan, drilling fist. The basic idea was the spiral. A spiral not only present when rotating out, the center rotates, thus the torso rotates. If the torso rotates, the upper arm rotates, and then you continue in that manner, creating an outward going spiral motion. But it already starts with the other arm. The other arm, well, making a scary movement or being tapped away by the other person, that's not relevant. What is relevant is that it is being moved. In the practice situation, it's being moved downward, or it is moving by your doing downward. And as soon as you notice, hey, my arm is moving, you change inside from noticing that the arm is moving to your sensitivity level. If the arm is moving because of whatever which reason, the upper arm is rotating. If the upper arm rotates, the center rotates. If the center rotates, the upper arm rotates, and there you continue. So you have a circle with the arm. Actually, you move through the circle. The circle stays on the spot, and you move with your arm through the lines of the circle, like that. Of course, with this shape. Then there is this circle. There. Then there is the spiral, starting on one side, hand, wrist, beyond the elbow, upper arm, torso, upper arm of the other arm, and spiraling out in the lower arm. And of course, the same gravity center rule applies as the one that I've talked about in Pi Chuan. So, Zhuan Chuan, let's drill ourselves away. And close. And as usual, a short talk about the step. This is the third step in the row. Pi Chuan being the first, Bong Chuan the second. This third step combines the specialties of the previous two. So actually, there's a teaching order in these steps. In Pi Chuan, the main teaching order was being aware of that circle, of this circle, and of the gravity center, so that you do not step forward, but you open the leg, and you allow the gravity center to fall, like that. Thus, combining all these elements into one. Bong Chuan. Well, of course, it has a bit the same, but because it has a continuously the same leg forward, that rotation is, well, it is there, but hardly noticeable. What is noticeable, the specialty of Bong Chuan, that is that skimming of the back, where you release the back, and thus resulting in, well, what a layman would consider to be a punch. We are just moving our position forward, and this is our position. So anyway, that back. Now, Zhuan Chuan combines the two. So there's this rotation. See? There. 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 Going around that circle. There. 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 Of course, there's the spiral, which is, according to the name, the specialty of this step. But like I said, there is more, because where does it get its power from? Well, the same thing applies like in Bengchuan, the back. So you have that rotation. When you have this rotation, you have this rotation as well. So this rotation complies with this rotation. There, continuously. In order to give it some power, give it a bite, you add the back, meaning that yes, there is this rotation and that rotation working together, but when your arm goes down, maybe again, I can't stress this enough, maybe because you want to tap on the arm of somebody else, or somebody else is slapping your arm aside. That's totally irrelevant, but you feel your arm going down, not only rotating, but going down as well, meaning that a weight is being added to your arm, a sensation of weight. Now, it's very important that not this happens when a weight is added, but this. Again, not in the hip joints, where the buttocks protrude out, but the soft part of the back. And not that much as I show now. Then skim over the soft part and release with a spiral. So it combines the specialties of step one and step two. Try to find that. Just move relaxed. Front view, rotate out, release the back with a drilling there, a drilling sensation. To the side again. and open and close. Good. Then there was the step that we've practiced last week and which is quite complicated, so we'll go through it again. Pao Quan. Again, Pao is a sound word for, well, an explosion, pow, bang, something like that. So it should be very explosive. And that's the tricky part. In Bong Chuan, it is obvious, wow, very explosive, bah, it's go moving out. In Pao Chuan, it's less obvious. You move in. It does not actually feel, it can feel very fast, but not, wow, what a power. That is because the other person experiences that explosive power. What happens is the following. I'll have to get a stick. The famous Xing Yi Spear. What happens is the following. Now, this is not a spear, this is the arm of an evil person. So, I intercept one arm more or less close to the elbow, the other hand grabbing the wrist, and instead of deflecting, I actually pull myself towards the punch. Bam! I stop it with my abdomen. That is already a surprising action. Then, because that freezes the other person for well, a hundredth of a second, then I move his arm up like that, having some pressure on the elbow, so the arm is in a straight line from the wrist to the elbow to the shoulder, and actually to the other shoulder as well, because by this pulling action, I have made his body, with the punch, turn in a following movement of the punch, like that. So he is totally aligned from hand, wrist, elbow, shoulder, other shoulder. That's what I try to achieve with this action. Then I move it slightly up, and by stepping out, why step out? That's for, I'll explain in a moment. And then I actually shoot out. I exert pressure in the line of his arm. And that's also why I rotate out. Rotating out. Here I intercept, then I align, but slightly stepping out. That means that this was his right arm. That means that if he punches with his right arm, doesn't matter which leg is forward, if he punches with his right arm, his body will not be totally aligned. Now, I already explained how this pulling motion, this intercepting motion, slightly aligns his body, but not fully. Now I'm the evil person, you might have guessed. If I have pressure on the elbow as well, lock the wrist, pressure the elbow. If I put straight pressure into this while he is not totally aligned, I will push him through the shoulder. But by slightly stepping out, I lock him, and now I push into the arm, and thus bouncing him away and damaging, severely damaging, if it's a bit explosive, severely damaging him in the joints. So that arm is not going to be used again. It's not because you break, because you don't, but it's because you exert pressure on the arm in a manner it's not supposed to receive pressure on the joints. Anyway, that's the talk. Now the movement. We'll start easy. Remember, the arm and the leg move together. They open. The arm of the moving leg becomes a fist. This is the hand that grabs the wrist. Then, in. Please remember from the previous time that you sink downward. So yes, you are moving backward, but you are feeling a downward force, bouncing up against the floor, up. The same leg doesn't step, it just is being released. There. And the rear leg follows. Of course, this again gives us difficulty when we want to practice on the spot. But for now, first this one side. Open up, rotate, in, up, out. The gravity line is above the rear leg. Up, gather, rise, out. A side story about the function is you'll often hear YouTube masters or real masters on your YouTube that the upper arm actually is a block against a higher attack with an arm. Yeah, well, you know, a position is just a position. You can do with it what your creativity tells you to do. So, yes, that's very well possible. But if you use that idea as the main function, as the central basic function, then, well, first of all, you lose the connection with the handling of a spear. Like I explained before, you block, step aside, and stab in. Well, now that's not that important, but you also lose the basic, well, line of power of the function where you move into the arm, thus compromising his structure and damaging the joints. If you use that as your central idea, then you still can use this as a block. But you will move correctly. Whilst as you use the idea of a block, then this will move outward and that will move outward. Because that's where your force goes. The force follows the idea. The chi follows the e. Let's try the other side. Weight above the rear leg. change sides. Got that? Return. Step back. Open up. On the other side. Of course, normally you would move out. And you would move out. But space problems. So on the spot, we have to make some adaptations. Move back. Again, if you're familiar enough with the movement, skim the back. At what moment does it fold? You're not putting the abdomen forward, but forward while you sink. So actually, you're moving your abdomen towards the fist while you're moving the fist towards the abdomen, but the body doesn't notice because you sink through the legs as well. But there should be a forward idea in the abdomen, otherwise not only will you fall too far, but it will soften the back. One of the things, hidden application, secrets, in this step is iron vest training. You hit yourself. Whilst breathing out into the abdomen that swells at the same time. So you can change sides, making your inside very strong and hungry. So I was talking about the back. That means that here, and then you speed up, making that bang against your belly. A belly bang, yeah. But this is where you fold the back. There. And this is where you unfold and release the back. Thus, moving out into the pouch and posture. There we go. Don't slap yourself in the groin. Let other people do that. Not. Unfold. Fold, unfold. Fold, unfold. Rise of Yang Chi. And close. Step number 5. Hung Chuan. Hung means horizontal. So a horizontal fist. And as a fifth step, it is an exception to the rule that wasn't mentioned before. All these four steps that we've just been practicing go forward. Hongquan does go forward, but it has a backward variation as well. That's just to make things difficult to you. Now first, the basic idea of Hongquan. You have your arm forward because you punch or you grab or whatever. And the significant other tries to grab your arm, maybe break the elbow in whatever which manner. He tries to do something with your arm which you do not like. Now, of course, it is all a matter of timing. If you are too late, then the damage has been done. The most stupid question you can ask in a martial arts school is when you're totally wrapped and locked, and then, Shifu, Shifu, how am I going to escape this? Oh, you're not, your arm is broken. You're too late. Sorry, your dad will bring flowers to your funeral. Stupid question. What is the right question? How do I prevent getting in that problem situation? We are not here to solve problems, we are trying to prevent them. Let's not make it happen. And that means that your arm, of course, we have to react, respond to something as well, so there is already physical contact. But it's not finished yet. The grab is not full, the force is not there yet. There's only contact. Of course, I'm talking about milliseconds. But you have practiced your qigong, you have sensitivity, so at that moment, again, notice the arm. Always guard the elbow. So as soon as you feel something on your arm, the first thing you do is not, oh, this nice technique, that nice technique. No, guard the elbow, otherwise you'll break it. So you guard the elbow, but we've already done this. You guard the elbow and you punch out. Now in this case, there is a second arm involved grabbing you as well. Or maybe the grab is actually a grab and not patting you aside. Or it is patting you aside, but your reaction is different. Who cares? This is the basic motion. Like I said, we've already responded to that, but now we respond in a different manner, maybe because a different type of problem might exist. But if things go right, then we will never know whether that problem would have evolved into that direction. What direction? Oh, he's breaking my elbow, something like that. Because when folding, we bring the other arm to it, the elbow as well, go underneath and move forward, like that. So the arm is being grabbed. Put weight on the elbow. Again, use the back to release your force. And now this arm slides along the other arm forward. Again, if somebody already has a forceful grip, then you will not be able to set him loose. So you have to be there before that. Of course, we have solutions if he does grab that, but if you get into that situation, you have been drinking coffee, you have been sleeping, you have been watching a movie, whatever. You've been not actually been in the moment. Now, this is not only about freeing yourself from a starting grip. Because it is partially, watch the hand, the lower arm, it has to have a certain height. Because I have to move over, well, the width of an arm here. Thus, setting myself free. Like that. Like that. Now, at the same time, we've talked about this with, well, for instance, Bong Chuan, where this could be a grab of the wrist and a break of the elbow, but you still punch towards the body. Zhuan Quan, same thing applies. So you grab the wrist or the other grabs you, that's not relevant. You go underneath the elbow of the other person, and while punching, for instance, to his face or whatever, wherever you can make contact, but you put pressure on the elbow as well. So one movement and two actions at the same time. Where do you get that for your money? Here the same thing applies. So there is a potential grab, you make contact and you release yourself from it with some violence, because he's not yet full force but already grabbing. So there. But also with the intention of making it into a push. There. There. That means that, and that's the difference with, for instance, Zhuan Quan, that freeing yourself is with a straight line. Not up like Zhuan Quan, there, but a straight line, there. Why is that? If somebody has already grabbed you, even though it's not yet full force, it helps if you use body weight. So now we get to the step. This arm being grabbed, this arm folding underneath, and the other leg, the leg of the grabbed arm, is light. Now, if I push this forward, that's where I go. Now, the full continuous step practice would be here. Rise, build up. Power release, and then to the side. I'm pulling this free, pushing this forward, but I'm using my body weight with the slight sideways step. Yeah? Good. Pichuan. Yeah? This step, the first one. There. There. I've shifted my weight from here, where it's 70-30. I've brought more weight to the rear leg, thus being able to release my front leg, slightly sideways. There. Then I use all my weight, leaning, so that he cannot break my elbow, but at the same time bringing the other arm forward and upward at the same time. And now I skim the back, I bounce out of my position, and I wah! There. And look dangerous, that helps. So in, leg out. In, leg out. I don't know if you've ever seen a slow motion movie of a bird in flight, but of course he's flapping his wings, and the flapping of the wings makes the body of the bird go up, down a little bit. But the bird's head stays at exactly the same height. The same thing you want to achieve in this step. So, there is this stepping sideways, but this is my direction. There, there. You want it to feel as a continuous direction. A straight line, and you move around that line, zigzag. Good, let's try to find a way to practice this on the spot. Start with Pichuan. You have to start somewhere. In, leg out. step back, in. Now try to make this the sitting in with your weight and leaning and folding the back and bringing the other arm underneath, one thing, and one thing out. One thing. One thing out. Don't look for an rapid explosive action. That'll come. Out. In. Out. In. Out. Remember that when you fold, don't look downward, because then the bending fold will become a hinging fold. Fold. And that, well, I said fold instead of fold, but that's what it actually is. It's a fold. And you will get problems there. Bending, okay. Curving, top. But hinging, wrong, bad. Don't do that. In, out. In, out. In, out. In, out. In, release. In, out. In, release. In, out. 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 Notice how the stepping aside gives my center a rotation, thus throwing the arm forward into a forward direction as well. So adding punch to the power. Now, the arm that's being grabbed in your mind. It's all too easy in this exercise, whether you can make a continuous step or practice on the spot, to when you fold, to retract that arm a lot. Like that. Don't do that. First of all, you have to feed the imagination of the, well, made-up reality where you are being grabbed. So you cannot pull it back because somebody is pulling that, trying to manipulate it. That's for one. Two, you need the arm being, well, slightly forward at least, because this rotational force that is throwing that out does not only come from sinking, thus rotating out. It also comes from the pull. So you have a counter force. This one going forward, that one pulling back. And thus breaking yourself free. Remember the song of Queen. That applies to this step. I hear you thinking, what song does he talk? Is he talking about? So do not pull it back too much. Smuggle yourself up and pull, yank. First release the leg and then yank the grabbed arm, yank it free. There. So keep it forward. Somebody is holding it. There. Break yourself free. mind closed. Good. Sit on the legs. Soften the back. Soften the neck. Open the head. Sink in the dantian. Open up, overstretch, gather, chi in the center, thumbs in the fist, eyes push out, that was it for today. Next week we'll look at the backward step of Hong Quan. Thank you for being here. Have a nice evening, and as usual, stay safe, stay healthy.